Welcome back to Toolsday. I figured today we would talk about a tool that since the beginning of Toolsday, people have asked me to talk about. So let's get into it. So today's video, I thought we would go over some miter saws. I actually haven't ever talked about miter saws. This isn't gonna be a tool fight. It's not gonna be a video about all the features of any individual saw. Really, it's just currently, this is kind of the saws we're using. And is it excessive? Yes, I do believe it is excessive. Nobody really needs three miter saws. However, since I'm fortunate enough to have the three miter saws, I can definitely tell you that each of them has its place on a job site. I don't think any of these are going to be perfect for any, you know, across the board job site if you're doing rough framing, fine carpentry. So that's really why I'm using all three of these, and I'll kind of take you through each one, a couple good, a couple bad takeaways, and what I'm using it for specifically. So what we're gonna do is we'll go ahead and we'll start with the Metabo HPT 10 inch miter saw. So we'll go ahead and start with some of the good features about the Metabo. First thing that I noticed when I got it was that for a 10 inch miter saw, it's very simplistic. The design, the overall just build of it is very simple. So it makes it lightweight. There's not a lot of frills to it. Obviously that's gonna, you know, take away some of the value to the saw, but for what I'm using this for, I went ahead and I set it up on the cut hub. You guys have probably seen the cut hub videos. If not, I'll probably put a link to it up here. I love the cut hub because it's kind of coming in and out of the trailer, going out on site, and being used to rough cut a lot of our material out on the job site. So this saw I chose to use on the cut hub because it's perfect for that. It has no problem cutting a 2x12. It's got a fairly, like I said, simplistic design. It just feels, you know, good to just go and rip a bunch of material. It's got the option for their AC-DC adapter, so you can plug in a battery. So yeah, that's kind of weird, but you can plug in the battery and run it off of shore power if you're doing that sort of thing, or if you're like me, typically 100% cordless on site. I just don't have any batteries at home. They're all in my job site trailer, so that's why I went ahead and plugged in the adapter. Another nice thing I liked about the Metabo is it's actually at home right now because I brought it home to do a bunch of trim work. I was making some window boxes and I wanted to give this saw a go doing some more detailed work since I've only really used it out on site rough cutting, and it definitely told me a lot about this saw. So I really like it for rough cut framing, but when I started doing some of the, you know, miter cuts and definitely looking for that really high quality cut, I found that this is gonna bring us into some of the bad things about this saw and where I would caution you if you're gonna buy it for fine carpentry. I mean, just right away, when you bring this saw out on the rail, it's not as smooth, it's not as precise feeling, and just, I can literally take my hand on the handle and flex the blade. Now, if you've done any sort of cutting with a miter saw, you know when you put a couple miters together, you want it to be crisp and perfect. And you can do that with this saw. You have to be super precise, super careful. And at any moment, that blade, if it hits a tough spot in some material, if you're cutting some hard wood, it can move and flex very easily. And that was a huge disappointment to me because I really was hoping that this saw would be great for the finished carpentry side of job site work. But I think it's gonna stay as my cut hub, rough frame, just knockout material because the battery does last really long. It does have good dust collection, universal in the sense that I can hook up any standard shop vac attachment to it. So that's great. But another thing that it does not do is it only does 60 degrees one way bevel or miter and about 50 degrees the other way. So not bad. But another thing I wanted you to know is that when I was setting this saw up to make like perfect miters, I was having a hard time. I realized it was because a lot of the flex in the saw, but it led me to look at the bevel adjustment and the ability to really fine tune the saw. And I found that there's really no way to adjust it unless I'm just really simple minded. I had to basically adjust the rail on the back, the actual thing you set your material to. And that's what I was moving side to side to get it to zero out versus a lot of these other saws, they actually have a bevel adjustment to it so that you can just easily change it, lock it back down. So that's kind of this saw in a nutshell. Do I think it is the best saw? No, I don't. That's why I'm not gonna use it to do any fine carpentry skills, but it's set up on my cut hub, which is what I use to do a lot of rough framing on the job site, and it does a really good job at that. I'm not going for precision. I want good quality. It's got lots of power. It does have a lot of power and the ability to plug in if need be, or just go ahead and use a battery, which, to be honest, I've never replaced a battery during a day of framing on site. So take that for what it's worth. This is just my two cents. Another thing I will say, that if you're left-handed, this saw is not gonna work really well because they've got the trigger lock here on the left side of the saw, which if you're taking your left hand in, there's really no good way to do it. It's definitely meant for a right-handed person. So there you go. Now let's go ahead and we'll talk about the Makita. Now, when we talk about the Makita, I've had this for about 6 to 9 months. I can't remember exactly. So I've definitely ran this saw a lot. I will start by saying a lot of people had problems with these saws right out of the gate. They came and they were really poorly, I guess, adjusted. So they had to do a lot of adjustment to the saw to get it kind of dialed in. Mine came right out of the box. I've done like no adjustment and it does a really good job. The first thing that I noticed when I used this saw is that it just has awesome power. It's super, like, just, you know, it's one of those things that when you use a power tool, you know if it just feels good. This saw feels really good. It glides back and forth on the rails real nice. The adjustments on the miter are just really nice and tight, and it just felt like a good saw. So that drew me in right away. But if it feels good, but it cuts like crap, that doesn't really do you much good. Now, the reason I use this saw still to this day is because it continuously cuts really good miter cuts. And that's about the extent of it. I mean, I'm not doing crazy crown moldings and everything else. I mean, you guys know what type of work I do, but whenever I'm trimming on site or typically in the shop, I do most of my trim work in the shop and pre-assemble it and take it to site. I always pull out this saw. And that is also because it's so heavy. Like, it is super heavy, so I don't wanna take it to site. I don't wanna mess with it getting, you know, bent out of shape or tweaked one way or the other. So this saw typically stays in the shop where I do all of my cutting. Do I need cordless in the shop? No. That is one of the downsides to this saw, I think, and Makita's platform is the double battery. I just don't like having to put two batteries in. Maybe I'm being a baby, but I like the fact that most other brands, one battery and you're done. Now, another thing about this saw that is a little bit of a pain in the butt is the dust collection. It does a good job. Like, it has the dust collection up here that's sucking dust off of the blade. And then it's also got the dust port back here that's getting the stuff that's coming out of the top of the material. So it does a good job with dust collection, but I still haven't even found a really good way to hook up to this system with my different dust collection tools I have. So that's one of those things that just, you know, be cautious that if you get this saw and you really need good dust collection, make sure you invest in the proper attachments to get to whatever dust collector you're using. Now, unlike the Metabo, or kind of like the Metabo, I can get to 60 degrees one way, but I can also get it the other way. So this saw allows you to cut a 60 degree miter either way. And, you know, all these saws that we're talking about are dual bevel sliding miter saws. And I don't think I would probably go any other way if I were to buy any miter saw. So that is one thing that's common between all of these saws. But in general, this saw stays in the shop and I use it to do my fine cuts, the things that I really want precise, because it just has a really good precision feel to it and it does a really high quality job, in my opinion. And another thing to notice, I haven't changed any of these blades. I'm still rocking the stock blade, which I know I probably should like replace these with a Diablo blade like right away and put a quality blade on. But for now, I just like to run the crappy blade out and just get a real good feel for the saw. So that's enough talk about the Makita. This is my kind of trim level saw. The Metabo was my framing saw. And now let's go ahead and talk about this little guy over here, the Milwaukee. So I know we just got done talking about two 10-inch miter saws. This is the 7 1/4 Milwaukee miter saw, and I had the 10-inch miter saw, actually gave it away to my brother who's behind the camera, because to me, it's basically the same as the Metabo. It's great for having it out on site, rough framing, but it does not do a very good finished carpentry side job. It actually fell out of the back of my Ranger as I was using it around my house, broke the handle, and I thought, all right, we're gonna go ahead and shelf that. I'll give it to my brother. He fixed it, loves it. It's perfect for what he's going to do. So I had a 7 1/4 as well. You could probably go back and see it in my feed. And I love that saw. However, my brother-in-law, my other side, he's a general contractor, and I gave it to him because he really needed something. And I thought it was the perfect fit for what he was doing, which was a lot of punchless stuff that he was going around. And so that is why I love this saw. Look at the size of it. It's super compact. It's super lightweight. I mean, I think it weighs 20 some pounds, but the first time you see it, you're like, come on, what is this really gonna do? I'll be honest, it's super powerful. It's not gonna cut your 2x12s, your tall crown moldings. But what I like about this saw is that it's very precise for what it is. It's very stiff. It doesn't have a whole lot of movement when you're using it, and it has tons of runtime. You can literally cut all day with this saw, hands down, with a 12-0 or a 9-0 battery. It's impressive. Another nice thing about this saw is being a 7 1/4, it is super easy to come by 7 1/4 blades, both rough framing or, like, you know, precision blades. It's super cheap to put a new blade in this saw. The dust collection is, it's okay. They've got a little bit of a universal dust collection system here with a couple different attachments that you can stick on there. So that's a nice thing I do like. Another thing is that this handle doesn't discriminate between lefties or righties. I feel like it fits both hands very well. So that's one thing that I think these other two saws don't do well. They're definitely made for righties. And I'm not saying this is not a right-handed saw. It definitely is geared towards a righty, but if you, and I think Greg likes to use his left hand, it's good either way. You know, kind of going along with the minimalistic design, the small size and all that good stuff, it also doesn't have a laser. The other two saws had lasers. This is gonna utilize the shadow line on the LED lights, which the lighting is super bright, and I find that shadow line super crisp. So if you don't know what I'm talking about, a lot of these other saws, when you turn them on, they give you a nice little laser line so you can know where to put your material before you cut into it and make a mistake. This saw gives you a crisp shadow line that is basically utilizing the blade to tell you exactly where the blade's gonna go. And I think it's awesome. It works really well. You don't even notice it until you notice it. And then it's like, why have a laser? I don't have to adjust this ever. It's always going to be perfect. Lasers, I've never had nothing but bad luck with lasers getting out of an adjustment. So I do think that's a great feature. But once again, this saw is limited due to its size. It's not gonna be there to cut all of your, you know, larger pieces of wood. You're only able to go 48 degrees both ways, so you're not going to get a big miter cut out of it, which typically is okay. 45 degrees is almost all you really need for general application. So this saw for me is more of my punch list. You know, I don't want to haul the cut hub out to cut a, you know, a handful of 2x, or maybe I don't want to bring everything home to do finished carpentry with the Makita. If I need something in a pinch, I can just pick this thing up and take it to wherever I'm gonna go, and it does a very well-rounded, all-around job. That's kind of where I put this saw if somebody's looking for kind of an all-around, maybe you want it in your shop, maybe you're not a contractor and you're just looking for a really good saw. I feel like Milwaukee did a really good job on this 7 1/4. Not the 10-inch. I'm not a huge fan of the 10-inch. The 7 1/4 is where it's at. So that kind of rounds up, you know, these three saws that I use and kind of why I use them, the pros and cons. Doesn't mean it's going to fit everybody. Doesn't mean I covered everything. There's definitely things that I'm already thinking about that I could probably talk about for hours, but I just wanted to do kind of a high level 2019 RR Buildings. These are the three saws that we're using. I have no doubt a year from now we'll be using something totally different. I'm blessed to be given a lot of these tools. And to be honest, my goal is not to share with you guys all rainbows and unicorns. It's to try to give you the pro things that I like and the things to look out for. So hopefully that was helpful to you guys. And you know, if there's certain tools or certain things that you're thinking about and you want maybe a professional opinion on, I'd be more than happy to share it if I have an opinion to share. Thank you for the support. If you haven't already, hit that subscribe button and look for more videos to come out every week. I appreciate the support, and we'll see you guys next week on Toolsday.